Would you welcome Brother Lee Stone King? I'm glad he's here.
Would you do that for the Lord? Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of Jesus forever. The Lord bless you. You may be seated. There is something I want to use as a preface to what I want to share with you and transmit to you tonight in the Holy Ghost. If it had not been for the miraculous healing power of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I already would have been in the grave for 1 year and 2 months at this present time. I was privileged to go back to Sydney, Australia in November of just this last year and preach again for my dear friend, Brother Ted Slack, and his wonderful congregation. And it was amazing because on Friday night, the first night of the crusade, it just happened to be November 12th. And November 12th, exactly 1 year before, I had lain dead on the floor of their airport in that city for over 30 minutes. So when I stepped in the pulpit, I said, I'm very glad to be back with you exactly 1 year later, alive and well. And they gave me basically a standing ovation. I had kept in contact with the ambulance driver and also Dr. Pitney in the hospital through the very kind, gracious auspices of the church there in Sydney, and also my own personal efforts. I had arranged, when I went back in November, to have some time with Nigel, the ambulance driver. And so we got together, and I was able to spend about 3 hours with him, and I was able to take him to lunch. And so I said to him, I said, Nigel, you're the only one that would really know, because you were the one that was with me. You were the one that took care of me. I said, I want to know what happened when you found me. He said, Lee, everything that could go wrong with your case went wrong. I said, what do you mean? He said, when we received the call from the airport, all we were told is that someone had fallen. He said, we get calls all the time that people have fallen at the airport on the escalators, injuring wrists or ankles or spraining something. So he said it was just a routine call as far as we knew. He said, but for some reason, when I left the ambulance, I felt to take the defibrillator with me, which I never do. He said, when we were walking just in through the airport, he said, a policeman came running and grabbed me and said, you've got to come quickly. This man is very, very sick. They're giving him CPR right now. He said, that was the first we knew that it was serious beyond just a sprain or some slight injury. He said, so we hurried. He said, when I walked into that restaurant that they had closed off, he said, and I took one look at you on the floor. He said, I knew that you were dead because this is my life's work. He said, and I fell on the floor and took the scissors and began to cut the coat and the shirt and the t-shirt off. He said, and we began to wire you immediately, he said, because the resuscitation had not worked and none of the CPR had worked. And they really beat me up because, and it's not uncommon for 3 or 4 ribs to be totally snapped in two, but thank God there was not even one slight fracture to any of my ribs, even though I was bruised and extremely sore. He said, Lee, he said, I wired you and we shocked you at 200 volts. He said, there was nothing. He said, so I turned it up to 360 volts. And he said, I began again. He said, but there was nothing. He said, and the bad thing was, he said, we just had a serious call before yours. A man had injured his head very badly. And he said, I forgot to check to see if the battery on my machine was charged. And he said, right in the middle of shocking your heart, my battery went totally dead. I looked at him. I said, what did you do? He said, the the paramedic that came in a few minutes after us, she somehow felt to bring her machine that she never feels to bring, and it was exactly the same as mine, and we were able to interchange the leads. And because you had fallen and dropped dead in a restaurant, there were outlets. And so he said it seemed like hours, but it was really only just seconds. He said, but we kept shocking. I said, well, Nigel, what happened when you shocked my heart? He said, Lee, your heart would beat once or twice, maybe three times, and just stop. He said, nothing worked. I said, well, Nigel, you're the only one that would know. When did I really begin to start breathing again? When did my heart really begin to beat? He said, it was not until we were in the ambulance with you on the way to the hospital. He said, and you were slated for DOA, dead on arrival. He said, because there was no hope as far as anyone knew. He said, but suddenly, on your own, he said, your heart began to beat and you began to breathe. I said, so then, Nigel, I was actually clinically dead longer than 30 minutes. He said, oh, yeah, at least 45 minutes. You were totally clinically dead. And I wanted to tell him, but I didn't feel that I should because I didn't feel he'd understand this. I wanted to say, Nigel, you know, Jesus was just trying to tell you he didn't need your help. He could do the job alone. But I didn't really think he'd understand that. So I didn't say anything about it. But we talked, and he said to me, he said, Lee, I have never seen anyone recover from what has happened to you. He said, in all the years of my work in hospital work, no one has ever recovered from what has happened to you. He said, in fact, next year when you come back, the ambulance crew is coming. We're going to tape you. They're going to give you a gold medal. He said, because no one has ever recovered from what has happened to you. I said, Nigel, I am a miracle of God. I am a miracle of God. So I had arranged to see Dr. Pitney, the maid doctor who took care of me, who had told my sister. She called immediately when she found out the news and said she was coming. And Dr. Pitney told her, he said, you can come, but he will not be alive when you get here. And so I just wanted to walk into his office. I didn't need a checkup. I didn't want any medical help. I just wanted to walk in with a nice sport jacket on, trousers, a white shirt, and just extend my hand to him and shake his hand and let him see what this Jesus can really do. And so when I walked in his office, I thought it would be about a 5-minute occurrence because I only wanted to thank him for all he had done for me. But it ended up about 25 minutes. He sat down in his chair and looked across at me. He said, Lee, he said, you look great. I said, well, I'm doing great. And then he pulled out the photos and the x-rays. And he said, I want you to have these. He said, the thing we were so concerned about, and I knew part of this, but didn't know all of it. He said, the blood had coagulated because I'd been dead so long. My body was cold. The blood had coagulated in my hands and in my forearms, in my feet, and this part of my leg. But what I didn't know was the blood had also coagulated in the heart. And he pulled out and he said, these three veins were plugged with blood clots. He said, at the top, he said, there was a huge blood clot, he said, that blocked everything. And what they told Brother Slack and those that were with him, they said, we've got to cut him open immediately to even try to save his life. And they said, no, we will pray. And so they stopped and they prayed. They took another set of photos and he put them in front of me. He said, we don't know what happened, but the blood clots disappeared. He said, we have no idea what happened to this huge blood clot at the top. It was preached here last night. We have more power with God than we understand. We have more power with God than what we understand as believers, because these signs shall follow them that believe. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And it was astounding to me. When they were talking, I was very attentive. But when I talked, they weren't paying attention to what I was saying. Their eyes would race over my shoulders and my chest and my face. They were remembering what they had done to me. And they could not understand. And they could not believe. And they still cannot understand. And they still don't know what to do with the fact that I am alive. Because medically, I am supposed to be dead. And I've looked at them and said, but there is a man called Jesus who is the resurrection and the life. He is able to raise the dead. He is able to heal any manner of disease in this house here tonight. And so I had a glorious time with Brother Slack and his church. And we had a tremendous move of God. But on the day it came time for me to leave the country and to return, I said to Brother Slack, as I leave Sydney today, I want to go to the restaurant where I fell dead a year ago, and I want to have breakfast there just before I step on the plane. And he said, no problem. And so we went, and he walked straight in ahead of me, and he took me to the very spot. He said, Brother Stone King, this is the spot here where you fell. I can't tell you the effect it had on me. I can't tell you. One of the waitresses recognized me. She came running and she grabbed me and she started laughing. She said, you look great. I said, I'm doing great. And then she disappeared. She went and got the owner of the restaurant and brought her. And the moment she saw me, she began to laugh. She said, you look great. I said, I'm doing great. And people, it's because of Jesus. It's because of Jesus. And so then we sat down there and we had tea and something light. But I positioned myself at a table where I could just sit there and chat with Brother Slack, Brother Nassif, Sister Gina. And I just wanted to, I kept looking at the floor where 1 year before I had laid dead for 30 minutes. I can't tell you what that has done to me, but it is a preface. When I left the country, I had a window seat on the plane, and I looked at the coastline of Australia as long as I could, and I kept thanking Jesus for the power that is upon us as a people. And people have asked me, they said, Brother Stone King, did you see anything when you were dead? I said, no. No. But I wondered about it myself because I've talked to people who have been dead and have been raised from the dead, and they've told me incredible things. And so I inquired of Jesus. I said, Jesus, but I didn't see anything. And he came to me and he spoke my name. He said, Lee, I know you too well. He said, if I had come to you, if I had talked to you personally and looked into your eyes, you would never have gone back. He said, you would have insisted on coming to me. And he said, it's not time for you. He said, I'm sending you back to help my people. I've lived for God for 42 years as of this year. I'm ready to go. I'm ready to stay. It's no big deal for me. I just want to do what He wants. But what I'm really saying to you tonight is this. Because He sent me back to help you, I now have become your personal possession. I will do everything and anything in my power to help any of you get where I know Jesus wants you to go. It doesn't even matter to me if you don't like me. I'm beyond all of that type of thing. I just want you to have it. I just will do anything to transmit to you what I know in the Spirit. And that's what this session tonight is all about. I will do anything in my power to help you. God is in this place. God is in this house. So would you lift your hands? Would you let your voice out before I read my text tonight? Jesus, I praise you and I worship you. Would you pray tonight for a spirit of revelation and understanding? Would you pray for a spirit of revelation and understanding? Lord Jesus, tonight, give us a spirit of revelation and understanding. Let us feel the brush of angels' wings. Help us to hear the sandaled footfall of the man from Galilee. Help us to feel the touch of nail-scarred hands. Give us, O Lord, I pray, and lift us into the realm of the supernatural. Let the gifts of the Spirit become imparted here tonight. The gift of faith to fall upon every man and woman of God. And the fivefold ministry to explode in this place tonight. I ask in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And everyone said, Amen. The Lord bless you. Would you stand? I want to read to you from the last chapter of the Gospel of Mark. In the last chapter of the Gospel of Mark, if you were to open my Bible, there are various verses in my Bible that have been initialed. These initials are TP. That means tried and proven. These verses I'm about to read, I have preached from probably more than any other in the New Testament, and they are initialed. In verse 15 of Mark's Gospel, chapter 16, and he, meaning Jesus, said unto them, Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Turn to your neighbor and say, that means you. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs, everyone say signs, shall follow them that believe. Say, that's me. Say, I am a believer. In my name, what is his name?
Jesus.
Say it again.
Jesus.
And again.
Jesus.
Shout it just one time.
Jesus.
And the very air trembles with the power and the presence of a living God. Oh. In my name shall they cast out devils. Say, I have that power. They shall speak with new tongues. Say, I do it every day. Or at least I think you should. They shall take up serpents. We know that means accidentally. And if they drink any deadly thing, I'm totally convinced it's accidentally. Ugh. They shall take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. Say, what an insurance policy I am covered with. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Say, I have that power. Say, it's alive inside of me. Touch your neighbor gently or hard, whatever you feel, and say, now you know what is wrong with me. Would you lift your hands and would you shout a praise and a worship to the Lord tonight? Jesus of Nazareth, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. We exalt you. We venerate your blessed and all-powerful name. I pray again that your hands will touch, that your feet will walk among us, that we will hear the voice of the Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. The Lord bless you. You may be seated. Would you clap one more time uproariously? And would you shout with the voice of triumph? Because there is triumph in this house. There is triumph in this house. I can feel it here, and I can feel it there, and I can feel it here, and I can feel it there. There is triumph spreading throughout this house. There is a victory and a triumph on this platform tonight. And because Jesus is here, anything can happen. Anything can happen. Anything can happen. Because Jesus is in the house. Yes. Jesus. 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 Oh.
Hallelujah.
God bless you. You may be seated. And the title of my message tonight is Because of the Times. Because of the times we live in, it demands our utmost for His highest. This is the last wave of revival, people. Another one is not coming. If we miss this wave of revival, we have missed it. We cannot miss this wave of revival. Brother Howell, we cannot miss what you were talking about. We have got to open the door. We cannot miss this wave of revival. Whatever it takes, we're going to have to do it like we've never done it before. Throw the pillow, throw the blanket, throw the whole house away. But whatever He wants, we're going to have to do it like we've never done it before. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Hallelujah. The Bible says, and if you read this carefully, if you study the Bible, even a casual reader comes to this conclusion. In the beginning in the church, every believer was a preacher. Every believer was a soul winner. They shook their world. There were 50,000 believers in Jerusalem. There were 50,000 believers in Antioch. They did it outside. The miracles were performed in the open. That's why they shook the world. They shook the Roman Empire from center to circumference. There was no lion that could eat it. There was no wall that could hold it. There was no fire that could burn it. There was nothing that could stop it. It was like a fire out of control. It was a raging force unlike anything that Judaism or religiosity had ever seen in the history of their existences. Because every man was a preacher, every woman was a preacher, and signs followed them. The miracles happen in the streets. You may be seated. You'll be up again, I promise you. You know what our problem is? We've kept this inside four walls. That's what our problem is. That's what our problem is. We've kept it inside four walls. But now it's time to take it to the streets. Now it's time to take it beyond these four walls. Let me tell you what's happened right here because of the times this year. Brother Jonathan Suber prayed for someone in the restaurant the other night, and they were healed, and the waitress was an eyewitness and broke down weeping and crying and received the baptism of the Holy Ghost in the restaurant. That didn't happen 2,000 years ago. That happened this week in this conference. It happened this week here. Yeah. Yes. That means He's the same. This Jesus is the same. If they did it, we can do it. If they did it, we can do it. And we're doing it. Clap again. Shout again. Dance. Reach out to somebody. Oh. Oh. I've listened to theologians. I've listened to scholars. I listen to professors, and they all say the same thing. It was Christianity in the end result that toppled the Roman Empire. Oh. We've heard so much about Islam being the fastest growing religion in the world. Nonsense. In the New York Times newspaper, the week after New Year's, it appeared a whole page saying that Pentecostal religion is the fastest growing religion in the world. In the New York Times. It had pictures of people with their hands raised, weeping, crying, speaking with tongues. In the New York Times. You know how many people get that magazine? Every country in the world gets that magazine. Because it is written, the Bible does not say in the last days Islam will cover the earth. It says in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. That's what the Bible says. That's what the book says. Hallelujah. Jesus. Jesus. Oh, In the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my Spirit upon all flesh. I was just with Brother Sham. What a marvelous Christian he is, from Pakistan, and his wife. He told me that in Pakistan, he had come from a meeting in Pakistan where over 365 Pakistanis had received the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking with tongues. He told me that one of the Muslim bus drivers had a huge growth on his leg, and those apostolic Christians said to him, may we pray for you in the name of Jesus? And he said, yes. They prayed for him and the growth disappeared. And the Muslim was on the platform that night with his hands in the air, giving Jesus, not Allah, but Jesus, praise and glory for his healing power. Do you understand me here tonight when I say to you, If you think that Jesus is coming back for a watered-down version of what you read about in the book of Acts, you are totally void of understanding. You don't have a clue, friend. He's not coming back for some watered-down version. He's coming back for a church without spot, without wrinkle. It's going to be 7 times greater than anything you read about in the book of Acts, because the latter rain was 7 times greater than the former rain. I can hear the sound of abundance of rain. I can hear the rushing mighty wind. I can hear it. I can feel it. I can dance it. I can shout it, because it's among us. It is upon us as a people. I got a report about 4 years ago, it's been now, a report done by a group of people who are not real fond of us. But they said, according to their research, that every 18 seconds, someone in the world is receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking with tongues. Every 18 seconds, someone in the world is receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Every 18 seconds. Every 18 seconds. You understand what I'm saying? If God pours out upon all flesh what He's poured out upon us, you have any idea what we're headed for? There's going to be dancing in the streets. There's going to be shouting. There's going to be an uproar. There's going to be a teardown. I mean, Anthony, if God pours out upon all flesh what you and I have got to hold up, it's going to tear this world to pieces. Oh. And I have been watching something in this last year in my travels. It is astounding to me. It is staggering to me what God is doing. I have met men and women I never knew existed that are powerful in the Spirit. They are gifted. They're reaching. They're involved with the fivefold ministry. They've got signs and wonders and miracles in their ministries. I never knew these people even existed. But I've been meeting them, and God is networking people together in this hour that are of one mind and one accord on the same page. You know why He's doing it? Because He is preparing to do a mighty work in the earth. And He's got to get a network of people together in a foundation and a channel through which He can flow, because He's got to have it. He is networking people together. I have watched in the services right here, and because of the times this year, He has networked some of you people together. Some of you have made a bond between yourselves that you never dreamed you'd be bonded with, because you're on the same page. And there's been a heart leap inside of many of you with excitement, because what you're really understanding is, I'm not alone in this. I'm not alone. I've got somebody who understands where I'm coming from. I've got somebody, Brother Elliot, that knows what I'm thinking. Brother Stark, you can feel it. There's a networking in this conference like nothing I've ever seen any place. There's some kind of a unity here. There is something being born because of the times this year that's never going to die. What's being born here is never going to die. What is being born in this house is never going to die. Something has been birthed here. If you concur with that, if you are excited at all, you ought to get a hold of each other. You ought to wave a hand to Jesus. You ought to shout to the Lord. Whatever your thing is, I worship you, Jesus of Nazareth. Yes. Jesus, you can feel the networking. You can feel the foundation. I can hear the rushing mighty wind. I can hear the crackle of cloven tongues of fire. I can hear the footfall of the master, Mike. I can hear the footfall of the master. I can feel the touch of the master's hand. I can hear the sound of his voice. There are angels on this platform. There are angels in the air. There's something hovering above you tonight that we're going to talk about in a few minutes. Powerful. Jesus. Jesus. I reiterate, as you are seated, God is preparing to do a mighty work in the earth. Throw your hands in there and shout, I'm ready, Jesus. Ah! Jesus. See, I am a believer. I was in Singapore in July this year. They have what they call an Encounter Jesus Crusade. And so I went. I was not able to spend a lot of time, but I went. And I didn't know, because they didn't tell me, Brother Willoughby had announced that I was coming to transfer miracle signs and wonders. That it was what is announced and advertised. They tell me when I get there. I said, all right. So the services began. And I had gone with the purpose of transmitting. I have a tremendous burden this hour, not to preach the traditional Pentecostal things we've always done, but I have got a burden to awaken our people to who they really are as believers and to what they really have a hold of and what they should be doing. And that's what I'm doing tonight. And so it began, and I worked with the transmission, and God began to do some things. People began to get the Holy Ghost. But then I was told on Friday night that Saturday night they were bringing two Muslim men in wheelchairs that were crippled. I said, fine. So they brought them. On Saturday night, when I walked in and sat down where I'm usually seated there on the front row, I sort of scanned the audience as inconspicuous as I could. And to my left, over here against the wall, there were two men in wheelchairs. And obviously they were of Middle Eastern descent. So I assumed that they were Muslims. And the Holy Ghost spoke to me and said, I will send them to you, but don't go until I tell you. And I'm very obedient. So I began, and all of a sudden, God was moving in that place. The younger man in the wheelchair had had a stroke. And his arm was in a white sling, and he was just sort of stooped over. But the older man, he had a huge towel over his shoulder, and he was drooling from the mouth, slobbering. Just, they had to keep wiping the spittle away. His hands and his arms were paralyzed, his feet and his legs were paralyzed. And he couldn't move, and he was in a nursing home. You know what this aged Muslim man told the apostolic Christians who witnessed to him? He said, since I've been put in the nursing home, my family no longer loves me. They don't come to see me. He said, none of my family comes. And he said, the God that I have prayed to all of my life, he doesn't love me either, and he can't help me. They opened their hands and said, but Jesus can, and Jesus does. I didn't know this till later, but while I was preaching, the people who brought him noticed his hands began to shake. His feet began to shake. They knew then that the feeling had returned, that the paralysis was gone. And all of a sudden, God spoke to me, and I walked down off that platform, and I went to that first man, the younger one in the wheelchair, and I took a hold of his arm that was not in the sling, and I said, "I'm not going to hurt you. Please don't be afraid, but I'm going to walk you in Jesus' name. You won't fall. I'll hold you up." And I slipped his arm through my arm, and I pulled him up, and I began to walk with him. You know, people, it's one thing to preach about it. It's another thing to go do it. You know why you don't do it? Because you're afraid of your reputation. I don't have any reputation but what he gave me. So I'm going to do it. If he does it, great. If he doesn't do it, great. I'm going to do it. So I pulled him out of the wheelchair. We began to walk. Every step, I kept saying, and I had a cordless mic, "In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name." That's where it's at, you know. I said, "In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name." All of a sudden, he got his weight. He was walking on his own. I said, "Folks, I'm steadying him, but I'm not holding him up anymore. He's walking on his own." And that Muslim all of a sudden realized that this Jesus I had preached was healing him. He pulled that arm out of that sling and began to raise that arm above his head in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And when he did, that audience came running. Those saints came running. They swarmed around him, and he lifted his hands sobbing, and God filled that Muslim man with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He began to speak with tongues. And then I went for the aged man. I did exactly the same thing. I leaned over to him. I said, "Pop, I'm not going to hurt you. Please don't be afraid. But I'm going to walk you in Jesus' name." And he had just seen what had happened to a fellow Muslim. And so we put his hand and arm through mine, and I pulled him up. And it was difficult because the muscles had become atrophied. They had not been used for so long. But I it was just tiny steps. I said, "In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name." And he was giving it everything he had. "In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name." We probably took about 15 steps, and all of a sudden he caught his weight. And I said, "Folks, I'm not holding him any longer. I'm just steadying him, but he's walking on his own." When I said that, I don't know how to explain this. It was like the place exploded. It was like it exploded with worship. The people were worshiping. I mean, and I don't know how to tell you this, but Jesus smiled. I could see him smile. He was so elated over the worship and the praise. And I feel him smiling in this service here tonight. I don't know how to tell you. I don't have the adjectives. I don't have the adverbs. I don't have the words. But I can feel him smiling in this place tonight. So because he's smiling, I want to clap a little bit. I'll jump up and down a few times. I'll lift my voice and just worship him. Jesus, we love you. We love you, Jesus. We love you. Yes. Those people came running. God gave that old Muslim the baptism of the Holy Ghost. He began to speak with tongues. And then, seated behind them, there was an aged Chinese man dying with terminal liver cancer. His body was skin and bones, just skin over the bones, but his stomach was swollen the size of a basketball with that cancer and the hideous infection, the fluids that had gathered. And so the people gathered around him, and I stood a little bit off, and I have a reason for doing that. But the people began to pray and worship. All of a sudden, that aged Chinese man who could not understand a word of English, doesn't speak English at all, tears began to flow down his cheeks, and his hands began to raise, and they began to tremble, and that old man burst out speaking with tongues while his Buddhist relatives watched. They had no idea. They could not understand what was happening to him. But the saints taught him in Chinese to be baptized in Jesus' name. And he nodded his head. He wanted to. And when they took him to the baptistry, and when that man began to climb in the baptistry, that stomach went flat just like that, right in front of their eyes. This is the only kind of Jesus I preach. This is the only kind of Jesus I'm going to preach. This is the only kind of Christianity I'm going to get into. I'm not into the traditional scene. I'm not into that. I'm into this. These signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They, believers, shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. They shall recover. They shall recover. They shall recover. It is written! Oh, I was just back there again in December, and when I walked into the service before we went into the camp meeting into Malaysia, it was amazing. I spotted the Muslim man on the front row who had had the stroke. When I saw him, he grinned, and I ran to him. I put my arms in him and hugged him. I said, "We are so glad to have you here. I'm so glad to see you." And he began to just tremble and shake. Brother Willoughby told me, he said, "Brother Stone King, that man prays hours and hours and hours every day. He reads his Bible by the hours every day." Do you understand what I'm saying here tonight? People, you can have this world. You can have what is out there. You can have the games and the nonsense and the politics. You can have all the rest. But just give me Jesus. I want to be with Him. I want to be involved with Him. I want to be involved with Him. I don't care about the rest. It's not important in the end result. Oh. And so I went to Pensacola, and Brother Welch is here. He can attest to this. And again, I felt to transmit and to work with this particular theme to help our people to understand, to become awakened to the power that is inside of them. Pastors, listen to me tonight. If you can get your people laying hands on each other in church, if you can get your people taking care of the business of God, guess what? He'll take care of their business. I learned 42 years ago, if I would take care of His business, He'll take care of my business. It'll cut your counseling to nothing, because if people get involved and begin to reach out, God will take care of their problems. He'll take care of everything. But we've got to get our people awakened to who they are. You're not just a nobody. You're not just a nobody. You are a somebody. With a power that this world knows nothing about. They do not understand that that restaurant will never be the same. That restaurant will never be the same, Brother Silver. It'll never be the same. This city is never going to be the same. You ought to throw your hands in the air right now and pray a surge of the Spirit of God into the streets of Alexandria. You ought to pray a surge of the Spirit of Almighty God into the streets of this city, because you've got the power to do it. You have the power to do it. And command it in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Jesus, hear us. Hear us. Hear us. Ask and it shall be given unto you. Seek and you shall find. Knock and it shall be opened. I was in Pensacola, Florida, preaching for Brother Welch. Wonderful people. I've known them for years. Love them. And Brother Kinsey is there now with them, of course. But I was there, and I was working with this theme. And on a Sunday night, the power of God just fell in that place. And I went down off the platform. I was working among the people, praying for people, and all kinds of things were happening. But there was an older lady that came to me, and she was crippled. She had some kind of a cane or something. And she said, "Brother Stone King," she said, "I'm all crippled. I'm in pain. I've been like this for 2 years." She said, I was driving my car. My husband was in the front seat. My sister and her husband was in the back seat. And she said, we were driving on some interstate, and she said, the semi truck in front of us jackknifed, and we could not avoid a collision. She said, my husband was killed outright. My sister's husband was killed. And she said, I was crippled and crushed. And she said, I'm just in pain. She said, I want to be healed. I said, do you believe that when I take hold of you in the name of Jesus, that you will be healed? She said, yes, I do. I said, then here it comes. I grabbed a hold of her hands. I said, I command you in the name of the Lord Jesus' body to be made whole. And all of a sudden, she went like this, and then she went like this, and she went like this. She began to kick her legs. She was healed instantaneously. God healed her instantaneously, because these signs follow them that believe. These signs follow them that believe. I am a believer. I am a believer. I feel like screaming that. I am a believer. I am a believer in Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. What was so phenomenal about that? That lady had brought a neighbor with her, and this neighbor saw this Pentecostal woman that was crippled healed, and she came running to me. She said, your brother Stone King? I said, yes. She said, you just prayed for my neighbor. I know she was crippled. I know her. She said, whatever you did for her, do it for me. I said, lady, here it comes in the name of Jesus. And she fell backwards healed. You understand something about Jesus? Jesus healed the publicans, the sinners. He healed anybody, everybody. You don't have to be in a Bible study to get healed. You don't have to be baptized in Jesus' name. You don't have to be a member of this church. If you need healing, this Jesus is a healer. This Jesus is a healer. He came to heal. He came to deliver. He came to heal. He came to deliver. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. You may be seated. Throw your hands in the air one more time and ask God to give you a spirit of revelation and understanding. Jesus, now, at this appointed time, give us a spirit of revelation and understanding. If you feel that God has heard you, would you just lift your voice and say, he has heard me. Oh. Listen. Listen to what thus saith the word of God. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 11, the Bible says, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. For what? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. If you are a student of this book, if you read it carefully and observe, you can understand that God wanted to create a kingdom for himself. But in order to have a kingdom, you must have a government. So he raised up apostles to govern this kingdom. What good is a kingdom without guidance? He raised up prophets to guide this kingdom. But a kingdom has to have subjects. So he opened the office of evangelist with anointing that was powerful to gather the subjects for the kingdom. But you can't just leave the sheep with no shepherd. So he opened the office of a pastor to guard the ingathering. And the word pastor and shepherd are synonymous within the context of the Holy Scriptures. But then he raised up teachers to ground them. So in the beginning, if you read it carefully and observe and are open, the apostles governed the church. The prophets guided the church. The evangelists gathered for the church. The pastors guarded the church. The teachers grounded the church. It is a master plan. It is flawless. The simplicity of its context and purpose and its magnificent effect staggers even the most intellectual mind. A master plan. A master plan. In the Old Testament, prophets were more powerful than the kings. The kings feared the prophets. I've been among you for 42 years and I've watched. We've always thought the position was power. Position is not power. Influence, anointing is power. But influence is like respect. You don't demand respect, you earn it. You don't demand. You can't manipulate or manufacture influence. It comes by years of service and faithfulness and living and preaching the truth and adhering to it. Influence is power. And those prophets were feared. I prophesy to you here tonight, before Jesus comes in the clouds of glory, the most powerful people on the face of the earth will not be kings or queens or dictators or politicians. It will be a man of God, a woman of God, who can step forth on the horizon of man's existence and bring down fire or stop the rain. The man who can step to the bow of the ship of a troubled life and calm the seas that are raging will be the most powerful people on the face of the earth at the end, before the coming of the Lord. I don't know about you, but I don't care a thing about politics. I want to get a hold of Jesus. I want his influence. I want his power. And whatever it takes, I want to have a hold of that. It's worth more than gold or silver. It's worth more than houses or lands. And can you believe that God has called everyone here tonight, no matter who you are, man, woman, young person, if you are preaching the gospel, God has entrusted to you the greatest call that a human heart and mind and life could ever see. He has called you to be an ambassador, a spokesman on his behalf. There is no higher calling. I've given most of my life to young people. I taught every young person under me, why stoop to be a king when you could be a preacher? Because it's the highest calling. It is the highest calling. It is the highest calling. And there is anointing in this place. There is anointing in this place. There is anointing in this place. Because God has placed it upon you. If you can feel the anointing that God has placed upon your individual ministry, I want you to shout about it just a little bit on your own. If you can feel the anointing, because you've got a right to shout about it. You've got a right to shout about it. Yes! Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus of Nazareth. There is no one in the entire world more powerful than a true believer in Jesus. They don't exist. Turn and shake the hand of your neighbor if it is appropriate and say, you have power from on high.
The anointing, the mantle of anointing, the fire of anointing to fall upon us as a people anew and afresh, that you will replace the virtue that has been taken out of every man and woman of God. I command in the name of Jesus, because it is written, command ye me. I'm commanding, Lord Jesus, that the virtue that has gone out of every man of God, every woman of God, be replaced now, 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 in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Hallelujah! Jesus, something very prophetic is about to happen. Something very apostolic is about to happen. You may be seated, because I need to inform you. Brother Barnes, Brother T.W. Barnes, who is a prophet of God, a dear friend, a mentor to me for years and years and years, he is a prophet of God. He does not hold an office. To my knowledge, he's never had an office. But no one has more influence in our movement than this man right here. People fly in to talk to him for 20 minutes or 30 minutes. They drive for hours from all over the country to just talk with him. People call him. Baptists come for deliverance. They don't go to their Baptist pastors. They go to him for help. And witches come. That's how powerful he is. One woman witch came to him, because he told me that she did, came to curse him. She called him and said, I'm coming to curse you. He said, come ahead. That's how he is. She came. She walked in his office. She walked around, cursed everything. You know, the curtains, the wall, whatever. And then she turned to him and she said, I'm going to curse you that you will die of exhaustion. You'll not be able to sleep at all at night. She did her thing and left. He told me about 2 o'clock at night. He said he woke up and he said, I could feel the devil in my room. He said, so I put my feet on the floor, sat on the side of the bed and said, devil, come here. And he's got to come. He has to come. Why? Because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. That's why. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Oh. Oh. When that devil came near, he said, Brother Stonekey, he came near. He has to. Brother Barnes said, now I command you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to go back to the one who sent you, and you do to her what she sent you to do to me in Jesus' name. And he said, that thing left. He said, I went back to sleep. He said, a couple hours later, my phone rang. It was that witch screaming and begging me to get that thing off of her. That's the kind of power we have a hold of. That's the kind of power that exists among us. I'm not talking about something 2,000 years ago. I'm talking about now, with this man that I know and you listen to and you see. Yes! So what am I saying? If the devil has come after you, send it back where it came from. You can send it back. You can send it back. You can send it back. And I'm talking to people tonight. You need to get a hold of something and send that devil back. Send him out of your life. Send it back in the name of Jesus, because greater is He, greater is He that is in you than He that is in the world. Yes! Oh, can you feel it? Can you feel it? Can you feel it? Can you feel the greater? Can you feel the greater? In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, by the authority of the Holy One of Israel, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Yes! You may be seated if you can. I'm coming very near to the end of something climatic. Oh. Oh. Oh, rocka, rocka, There is something hanging in the air above us as a people, as a movement in this hour, like a mother heavy with child that wants to be delivered. There's something in the air above us. I preached at a general conference. I'm preaching it here tonight. That something is the fivefold ministry that is trying to fall upon us. And God spoke to me this afternoon and told me that He would impart the literal offices of the fivefold ministry in this conference tonight to men and women of God. If you are here tonight and you've ever had a desire to have a prophetic ministry, to occupy the office of a prophet, don't do it till I tell you. But that thing, that office is hovering above your head. If you've got a desire for that, I want you to throw your hands in the air and begin to cry to Jesus now. It'll fall on you. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. It's on the platform, Brother Barnes. You can feel it coming. It's upon missionaries. It's upon missionaries. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it right there. That's it. Yes, receive it. Receive it. Receive it. It's in the balcony. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. In the name of Jesus 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 of Nazareth. Can you feel it, Brother Kleindienst? Can you feel it? That office is upon you. That office is upon you. You're never going to be the same after tonight. You are never going to be the same after tonight. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, Jesus. Atala taraka rashata. Atala taraka taka taka rashata. Atala taraka. There's apostolic authority upon you. God spoke to me last night and told me He had given you the mantle of an apostle. He spoke to me last night and told me it's upon you. You're going to guide your organization with apostolic power and authority like you've never had it before. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. In the name of Jesus. You got it, man. You got it. You got it. That's it. That's it. You got it. Yes. Reach over to somebody. Get a hold of somebody right now and claim it with them. Claim it with them. Rejoice. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We've never done this before. We've never had services like this before. But it's time. It's birthing. It's birthing upon us the fivefold ministry. Missionaries, get a hold of each other. You missionaries, get a hold of each other. The fivefold ministry is upon you. Not only the office of a prophet, but the office of an apostle. It's upon you. It's upon you. It's upon you. Hallelujah. you feel you've got that office, if you feel that mantle has come upon you, would you rejoice in thanksgiving, however you feel to do it. In the name of Jesus, it's in the choir loft. It's in the choir loft. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Now with your new anointing, I command you to get out of your comfort zone. Get out of that seat. Go after somebody. Pray for somebody you've never prayed before and command it in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, because people are being healed. Tumors are disappearing here tonight. Cancer cells are being burned out. Deafness is beginning to clear. Blind eyes are beginning to see in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, by the authority of the Word of God, by the power of the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Receive it, receive it, receive it, receive it, receive it. Yes! Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Does anybody feel like shouting, I'm never going to be the same? Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. This may seem very strange to you. This may seem very unorthodox to you. But whatever you feel it is that God has given you, whether it's an office in the fivefold ministry, whether it's the demonstration of the Spirit of God and power, whether it's a gift of faith, I want you to turn to some neighbor that's close to you and say, I've got this. It now belongs to me. You're going to have to claim it. You're going to have to possess it. It's not enough to come to these services and just touch it. You need to possess it. You need to possess it. God told Abraham, I'll give you all the land you walk upon, but you're going to have to possess it. It's not enough to walk upon this and because of the times. You're going to have to possess it. In the name of Jesus, I've got it. It has been imparted to me. I am never going to be the same. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth.
You can't believe what God's done in this place. I feel like there's one more wave here. If you'll turn, lay hand on somebody. I think God's going to make one more wave through here before you leave and drive home or fly home. Now reach over and from the depths of your soul, it doesn't matter if you get drunk on the Holy Ghost, shout together, call out. Get the Holy Land. Let that rushing mighty wind heal. Prepare our churches.
I would like to know how many people are here tonight that need a healing in your body, any kind of a healing. How many people are here tonight who need a healing in your body? Would you raise a hand so I can see it all over this place? Just those of you who need some kind of healing in your body. The gift of faith is in this house. The gift of faith is in this house. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. If you will lift both hands and begin to worship God, in the name of Jesus, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God will come upon you. Healing will fall upon you out of this tremendous canopy that is covering this congregation in this great conference. Receive it in the name of Jesus. Release your faith in the name of Jesus. Jesus is here to heal all manner of disease here tonight. I don't have to touch you. I don't have to pray for you. Jesus is in this house. The gift of faith is in this house. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. Receive it. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth. In the name of Jesus of Nazareth. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. I can tell you in the spirit tonight, all manner of diseases have departed from people's bodies in this house tonight because of the presence of Jesus, because of the gift of faith that is in this house. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. The Holy Ghost. The Holy Ghost had just spoken to me. There are people in this place tonight. Please don't be ashamed. Please don't be afraid. We are here to help. But if you've been fighting a mental battle and your mind is about to go 40 directions, if you will lift your hands and begin to worship God, you will be healed of that mental agony instantaneously. That's it. That's it. That's it. That's it. Receive it. Be thou made clear. Clear every mind. Every mind. Every mind. Every mind. Every mind. That's it, that's it, that's it, that's it, that's it. Yes! In the name of Jesus, 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 that's it right there, that's it right there, that's it, son, that's it, in the name of Jesus, 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 you can feel it, you can feel it, atala tarakatakashata, atala tarakatakotarakashata, in the name of Jesus, that's it, that's it, that's it, clear, 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 clear. Hallelujah! Hallelujah, Jesus! You wonderful people! You wonderful people! I know you are tired. You've been going noon, morning, noon, and night in this meeting. But I wonder, do you have enough strength? Do you have enough energy to clap one more time and just shout with a voice of triumph in the house? Hallelujah! To leave here. I really don't want to leave here. I kept feeling I should tell you this, so I'll tell you real quickly. I was in a meeting like this, in a camp meeting in Asia. The Holy Ghost spoke to me and told me, he said, the office of a prophet is hanging among the people. He said, and the office of an apostle is hanging among these people in this camp meeting. They were there from many nations all over in this particular camp meeting. And so I simply announced, I said, that office of a prophet is hanging above your head. I said, if any of you have ever wanted to be prophetic, you've ever wanted to work in the realm of a prophetic office, if you will just stand to your feet,
It was like an explosion. Those preachers, those missionaries jumped to their feet, threw their hands in the air. It was like an explosion, and I could feel the thing go to them. But a most unusual thing happened. And the reason I'm telling this is because I feel like something like this has happened here tonight. There was one man there. He raised his hands and didn't feel anything. So he raised his hands higher, and he said, "But I don't feel it, but I want it." And two hands grabbed his hands and began to roll them in circles like this in front of him. He thought a fellow preacher had got a hold of his hands and was moving them in circles. But he could feel such power. He opened his eyes. There was no one standing there. But the hands that had a hold of him would not let go, and they kept moving his hands. It was an angel of the Lord that had come to him. He has totally changed. That man is totally changed. I have a feeling that there are things like that that happen or are just about to happen to some of you, because some of you are on the very edge. You're on the very edge of entering into a realm you've never been into before. So if you have the strength and you want that, just lift your hand and worship one more time. Am I talking to you? Am I talking to anybody? Am I talking to anybody here? Am I talking to anybody here tonight? There are angels of God in this house. Angels of the Lord are in this house. Of Jesus. Lift your hands and worship the Lord. I was right. There was a man over here. Something took a hold of his arm and lifted it up. All the pain is gone. The shortness of breath is gone. He can't take his arm down. He can feel something all the way down to the elbow. I tell you, people, God is in this house. The miraculous is in this house. This man is being healed right here. This man is being healed right here. People, that's it. It's time for the dancing. It's time for the shouting. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord with that man right there. Would you do that? Let's just thank God for the healing.